Heavenly Father, we're so very thankful for this time we have to come together to sing these songs of praises to you, to hear a message from your word, to remember Jesus and the sacrifice for us. Heavenly Father, we're so very thankful for the victory that we have in Jesus. Help us to always remember what's been done for us. We pray that you might continue to use your body here. We pray that you might watch over our leadership and be with them. We pray that you might be with all of our number who need your watchful hand and be with them in their needs at this time. I pray that you might be with us this morning as we conduct this worship service, and be with Steve as he brings us a message later. Pray that we might do everything in a manner pleasing to you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
To have a prayer in mind for partaking of the Lord's Supper, at 369, if you want to look at the book, 369, it is finished.
It is finished. The battle is over. That's a great song, isn't it? Isn't it nice to be able to get around the Lord's table and to know that the battle has already been won? To know that the emblems that we're going to partake of remind us of our brother, God's Son, our Savior, took our sins to that cross. It's sad he had to do that. But because he did that, our war is over. We can't stand before God because of the washing of his blood, the giving of his body on that cross, being that perfect sacrifice. We can be pure and white before God. We can speak with God in his name and know that our prayers are heard. So as we gather around this table this morning, and we think what we just sang, that battle's over for us, and we strive to do his will. Would you please bow with me as we go to our Heavenly Father? Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you around your table, the table that's been prepared for you, by you, Heavenly Father, for us, to remind us, Heavenly Father, of that dear sacrifice of yours, your Son, for us. Heavenly Father, we truly aren't worthy, and we know that, but we truly do thank you for these emblems at this table and your Son. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to take this bread of life, Heavenly Father, which truly is our life, that sacrifice on that cross, that pain and that anguish that your Son took because of our sins, Heavenly Father. The sins that we commit daily, Heavenly Father, either of omission or because we do it on purpose, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we strive not to do that, but Heavenly Father, we thank you for that perfect sacrifice, and we thank you for you and what you've done for us. As we partake this bread, let each of us see the cross and see your Son. Be mindful of what he did, what you did for each and every one of us, and how important we are to you, Heavenly Father. We are so important that you had to sacrifice your Son so that you could have a relationship with us. And we thank you for that, Heavenly Father. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come to the time of the worship service, we're going to take up a collection. Every once in a while, I like to, as I did know to say, go back and read the directions and do something. Today I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians 16th chapter, the first two verses. Now about the collection for God's people. Do what I told the Galatian church to do. On the first day of every week, each one of you should set aside some of money in keeping with his income, saving it up so that when I come, no collections will have to be made. Now, if you understand the context of what I just read, they're talking about taking up money to go back to the church in Jerusalem. But it's an example of giving. It tells us how to go about doing it. Set aside some money according to our income. Personal decision. Save it up if you have to. But on the first day of the week, we do it. And we do that. I've said this before, and I don't want to overbeat a point, but sometimes I feel the collection is the stepchild of the Lord's table. It just, how easy is it to reach in your back pocket and grab a piece of paper cloth? Write a check. Doesn't take a lot of thought. Let's take a moment to give it just more than a little thought. Let's think about what we're about to do. Return a portion of God's money back to Him. It's His anyway. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I humbly approach you in prayer to ask a blessing upon this congregation as we're about to return. A portion of the gifts that you've given to us. Lord, help us to give this back to you in a manner which is both in your sight. But Lord, also help us to use it in a manner which is well pleasing in your sight. Be with those who will make the decision how it's to be spent. Help us to spend it in a way that's most productive to growing the church and furthering that word here in this town and throughout this world. Ask this prayer through Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you. this scripture comes from Romans 8, 37 through 39. No, in all of these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is Christ Jesus our Lord.
Good morning. Do you feel victorious?
Yes.
I don't think you do. I know, it's cold, it's not sunny. But we are victorious. I mean, everyone likes to be victorious. I don't think I've ever heard anybody who's getting ready to compete say, man, I sure hope we lose. We want to be victorious. We want to be winners. Now, some people want to be more than victorious. They want to crush the opponent. Crush them into submission. God gives us some great promises. But I don't think many are greater than the one we find in our scripture reading. Through him, we are more than conquerors. You know what that means? Nothing can defeat us. Nothing can put us down. God has all the power. And God says, you, my children, are winners. You're going to win. Not only can we be victorious, not only can we be conquerors, we're going to be more than conquerors. Now that's saying something. First, we like to conquer. Like we said, everybody likes to be victorious. And God makes us more than conquerors. I mean, you think about what it means to be a winner. I always laugh when I'm watching football and when they go to interview coach, they say, what will you have to do to win this game? Well, the answer should always be the same thing. I mean, the coach comes up with what they call coach speak. But I always say, if they'd done that to me, I'd say one thing. Score more points than the other team. That's all you got to do, right? God allows us to do that. Look at Romans 8:37 once again. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. Since God has all the power, and since we are God's children, and he is able and willing to give us all that we need and conquer anything in life. Now, sometimes that's hard for us. Because, frankly, life doesn't always go the way I have imagined, does it? It doesn't always go the way that I think it should go. But God said, you know what? You're still going to be more than conquerors. You're still going to be victorious. It doesn't have to be the way that we think it should be. It just doesn't have. Sometimes bad things have to happen in order for good things to come out of it. Make sense? Let me go back to my big fandom of football for a minute. Coming into this past college football season, my beloved Tennessee Volunteers were chosen to win the Eastern Division of their conference. Their very first game was against a tiny school called Appalachian State, who just now, just maybe
level of college football. It's what you call a cupcake. It's a tuna. We're going to go in and play this smaller school and we're going to just pound them. It came down to the fourth quarter, Appalachian State beating Tennessee. Steve wasn't very happy. Finally, Tennessee scores to tie the game to put it into overtime. Should never be this close. Fourth down, Tennessee has the ball and their overtime, that stopped Appalachian State. The quarterback takes the ball to the side. He's going to run into the end zone. Just as he gets to the goal line, he gets hit and he fumbles the ball. Tennessee player falls on it in the end zone. Touchdown, Tennessee wins. Without that fumble, Tennessee loses. Bad thing happened for a good thing, at least in my opinion, to happen. And it happens in life. Sometimes we don't know why situations were put in and turn out the way they do, and we don't know why they're happening, but God says he can use any situation for good. So we trust him. Because he has all the power. God revealed his love to us, and that should mean so much to all of us, just to know how much God loves us. Regardless, God loves us. Look at Romans chapter 5 and verse 8. It said that God demonstrates his own love for us while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. What Jesus said is the greatest display of love for a man who laid down his life for his brothers. While we were still sinners. So this tells us when somebody says, well, I got to get my life straightened up before I can come to Christ. No. While we were still sinners, God sent his son. You see, we cannot fix our life without Jesus. That's like saying, I'm going to go out and change the oil in my car without using any tools. The only way we get our life in order is to give it to God. Let him fix it. Because he loves us so much that he gave his one and only son. So the question we need to ask is, what is the ultimate victory? Well, look at what Paul says, 1 Corinthians 15:54. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with the immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. I mean, we hear people say, do you want to never die? Well, we're all going to die. The Bible says it's appointed for all men to die once. And all that means is this body and soul is going to separate. That's all it means. That's what can happen to every man. We may not all die and be buried or be cremated, whatever it is. But this body and our soul is going to separate because this body cannot enter heaven. Paul says that earlier. Flesh and blood cannot enter heaven. So it's going to separate. But that second death, that's the one he's talking about. Total and complete separation from God. You see, when we put our lives in the hands of God, we cannot be separated from him. And that's what Romans chapter 8 is talking about. It doesn't matter what happens in life. It doesn't matter what goes on. Nobody, nothing can separate us from the love of God. That's victory. Be victorious over us. What can?
we do look at death as that final gun in the game of life. But death has been defeated. Death has been conquered. Because God loved us so much that he sent Jesus while we were still sinners. Because we couldn't straighten ourselves out. Now, as we just mentioned, nothing in life can separate us from God. Paul assures us that we cannot be separated from God. He assures us that there's nothing stronger than that bond. I mean, the greatest relationship we have has to do with God. Because the relationship with God is the only thing we take with us beyond this world. The only thing goes with us. Romans 8:38 says, "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present or the future, nor any powers can separate us from God." I mean, look at that list. Nothing has the power to put God over there and us over here and put something in between. Nothing. Including life itself. I mean, you ever heard anybody say, "Well, I was going to do this or I was going to do that," but life just got in the way? Sometimes life does just get in the way. A lot of times when we're young, we make big plans. Here's what's going to happen. Here's what's going to happen. I'm going to do this. I'm going to accomplish this. And then all of a sudden, something happens and just changes the whole path. Life gets in the way. Life may separate us from our goals. Life may separate us from our desired destination. But life cannot take us away from God. Life cannot separate us from God. Why? Because God gives us the gift of life, and what he puts in life, we're to deal with. Whether it's good or bad, either way, we should draw closer to him. We put our hand in his and let him lead us. Not only life, but death cannot. I mean, think about it. Think about the way life can separate us. It's not life itself, it's our decisions. The things that we do, the things that we decide. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10, life got in the way of Demas. For Demas, because he loves this world, has deserted me and has gone to Thessalonica. Sometimes things in the world catch our eye. They're attracted to us. That's what happened to Demas. Did his action, did his life separate us from God? No, his decision, how to live his life, did. Separated him. It took him away from his calling. It took him away from what he was doing. But I don't think God deserted him, and I don't think God said, "Well, so much for that guy." Why? Because God always loves us. God always cares for us. Just because he allows us to make decisions that may take us away from what we should be doing doesn't mean he doesn't love us. He gave us the ability to think. He gave us the ability to use our common sense. And and he says, "You've got to learn." Think of the rich fool that Jesus talked about in Luke chapter 12, verses 16 through 21. "Oh, I've been so successful. I've got all these crops. I don't got nowhere to put it. So I am going to tear down my barns and build bigger ones." And God says, "You fool, tonight your life will be demanded of you. Now who's going to get everything that you got?" God didn't separate. the decision to put my, for this man, to put his faith in his riches, separated him from God. In the same way with the rich young man in Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 22. I mean, he thought he had it made. What must I do to inherit eternal life? Follow the commandments. Great. I've done that since I've been a little kid. Oh, one more thing. Sell all that you have, give to the poor, then come and follow me. Sorry, God, my faith isn't in you. It's in those things you tell me to get rid of. See, it's the decision that separated the man from God. See, the neat thing is, death can't even separate us from God. Death can't even keep us away. Solomon wrote in Ecclesiastes 12:7, and the dust returns to the ground from which it came, and the spirit returns to God who gave it. So everybody needs to know that their spirit is going to return to God. Now, what God does with it, at that point, what God does with you, because your spirit is really who you are, it's not the body. That's just how we recognize it. It's up to us. What's God going to do with us when our spirit returns to Him? It's our choice. Because He's given us all the direction we need, all the instructions we have to have. He said, here's the two paths of life that you can follow. One leads to eternal life, one leads to eternal condemnation. You make the choice. You choose which path you want to take. But your soul is going to return to God at the end of this journey we call life. And your decisions are going to determine where you spend eternity. How you decided to live your life. So even death can't really separate us from God unless we are condemned and we get that final death. That final separation. Complete and total. Nothing in all creation can separate us from God. Nothing. I mean, think about what that means. It doesn't matter what happens. It doesn't matter what goes on. It doesn't matter what is all around me. Nothing can separate me. Nothing can separate you from God. I mean, there are a lot of amazing things in this world that can grab our attention. A lot. But it's more important that we focus on God. Because nothing is more important than that relationship. See, when we get our focus off of God and we start focusing on things, then we start to separate ourselves from God. We start looking in the wrong place. Our faith goes in the wrong direction. Look at what Paul wrote in Romans 8:39. Neither height nor depth nor anything in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing in all creation. You see, the promise that we get here is that God will never stop loving you. I mean, because we talk about class. People will let us down. People will disappoint us. God will never let us down. I mean, the Bible proves that time and time again. People in God's care, they do what God says. God cares for them. Even the people that shook their fist in the face of God, God said, fine, make your decisions, but He still loved them. He still took care of them. He still blessed them in many ways, but He allowed them to go astray in hopes that they would understand just how important See, Paul wrote in Romans 1 about those who shook their fist in the face of God, who decided they would worship the created rather than the creator. And he says God gave them over to that evilness. God let them choose to walk that path, and he didn't keep them from doing it. But his hope was that they would return. That they would see, look, we kind of had it made. And now, we don't. Pay close attention to what Paul says here in the last part of verse 39. When he says, nothing is able to remove us or separate us from the love of God. Just keep that promise in mind. We're going to make mistakes. We're going to fall down. We're going to give in to temptation. But God does not stop loving us. I mean, that's when we really need to depend on God more, right? If you want to compare, you can say that. I mean, we just need to depend on God all the time. But when we know we fall short, that's when we really need to focus on Him. Because Jesus loves us unconditionally. And it's up to us to receive that love and all the blessings that come with it. Or ignore it. Our choice. Because Jesus doesn't force His way into anybody's life. Unless we invite Him. What separates us from God, we find in Isaiah 59:2. But your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden His face from you so that He will not hear. That's not to say God quits loving, but what He says is, if you insist on living a life of sin, if you insist on ignoring what God says and you want to be the sinful person, that's what separates you from God. That's what keeps Him from hearing you, because you made the decision. You made the choice. And this shows that only we as individuals can separate ourselves from God. Only we can end the relationship. Nothing in life, nothing in death, not God Himself, because He won't do that. But I don't want you to let verse 1 here in Isaiah 59 go unnoticed. Surely the arm of the Lord is not too short, nor His ear too dull to hear. We're never out of range of God. He can always reach us. He can always hear us. Because we know He always loves us. So He always cares about us. Friends, God wants us to be more than conquerors. And He promised every victory that we want. And He promises many more. Does that mean things are always going to go my way? Not what that means at all. But we can know that God is always with us. God is always going to give us victory. And we can share in all those promises as long as we trust Him. As long as we put our all in His hands. We want to be more than conquerors. It's entirely up to us. As individuals, it's entirely up to us to put our hands in, put our life in the hands of God. To look at Him face to face. Say, God, I want to be more than a conqueror. And I can only do that. So if you're here today and you've never been baptized for remission of sins, that's the first thing. That's you get to conquer by giving your life to God, allowing Him to wash you clean of all sin,
starting new.
Christian, maybe you struggle. Maybe you don't always believe the promises of God. Maybe you struggle in life with something. Take it to God. Tell Him you want to conquer whatever it is because you want Him to be your Lord and Master. If you need the prayers of the church for any reason, the church will be glad to pray for you. You just come down and take a seat and stand with us for a second.